Thank you guys so much for tuning in to another episode of Business Spotlight. I'm so excited that you have decided to tune into the show today. We have an awesome show today. I actually have Marcia Haygood on the show. She is actually the founder and president of Stepwise Associates. She's a motivational speaker, leadership development expert, and empowerment coach. And I'm so excited that she's on the show again. She was first originally on my Authors to Know and Books to Read show to let us know a little bit more about her book called The Little Black Book of Success. And it was just such a great show. Marcia, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thanks so much for inviting me back to be on this show with you.
You are welcome. So we can dive in a lot deeper into Stepwise Associates. Marcia, please let the viewers know a little bit about yourself.
Well, first of all, thank you again for inviting me to be on your show. I am the founder and president of Stepwise Associates. I have had my company for 13 years now. I've been an entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. And prior to that, I was in the corporate arena as executive vice president of human resources. And I actually planned to be an entrepreneur, took some time, but I put some plans in place to start Stepwise because I saw so many people, predominantly women, mm-hmm. who were making avoidable mistakes. And oftentimes when you work in human resources, you want to tell people what they might do differently.
Yeah.
But also don't want to get the company in trouble. Uh-huh. Or saying what you really think. So sometimes I would be coaching people outside of the company, mm-hmm. and really started my coaching practice that way. I decided to start Stepwise. And as I said, it's been now 13 years that I have been offering both coaching to both individual and group coaching. I started off doing individual coaching. I now do more group coaching, but I also do public speaking. I'm a keynote speaker. I do keynotes, panel discussions, full and half day seminars, and hourly workshops at organizations and corporations where people could really use or benefit from success tips. And I offer success tips to my audiences and my clients.
That's good. That's good. So I know that you said that, you know, there were times that you were giving advice to individuals, you know, just as an executive, and you just felt like, I guess, that internal battle, like, oh, should I say this or should I not?
Exactly right.
But was that your entire motivation of wanting to actually establish Stepwise so that you could really just dig in deeper and help individuals in this area?
Absolutely. Absolutely. First of all, I should share with you that I love giving advice. So we should start there. Okay. And my goal in life had been to become a talk show host.
So really?
That I could just give advice. Oh, absolutely.
So cute.
I would love to do that. Talking and giving advice. This is what I love to do. But I also think that I've said to people, now I say, I am building a legacy. I no longer have to build a resume. I'm now building a legacy. And my legacy is to offer people a place, a confidential, safe space to talk about what they want to do and talk about some mishaps that they may have had or some challenges that they go through. And so working as both a coach and a speaker, I can offer stories, I can offer strategies, I can offer tips to people who want to move to their next step, whatever that step is. Mm-hmm. So the audiences that I'm speaking to are all ages. As I said, they're predominantly women, but they don't have to be. And I'm really talking about options that they may not have thought about. So I become their strategic thinking partner, if you will.
Now, let me ask you this, because I have since I started, you know, became serious about becoming an entrepreneur, I've just been hearing a lot about, you know, creating a legacy for yourself. And I don't want to act like that's the new buzzword, but because maybe it's just Martinique just now starting to hear it a lot. Yeah. You know, what is the importance of building this legacy for yourself?
Well, you know, I think that you start building a legacy when you have gotten enough experience or enough exposure to be able to share it. I think at a younger age, you're still going through what you need to go through. And I have to tell you that both the good things that I've been through and some of the challenges that I've had have helped prepare me for what I'm doing now. And I can share that so that hopefully the people that I'm talking to can avoid some of those mistakes or some of those issues that they go through. We are going to have some ups and downs, but they don't have to be ups and downs that stifle us or keep us from growing, keep us from moving forward. So when I say building a legacy, it's really to be able to offer people some alternatives so that they'll have options. They'll have choices. They definitely always had choices, but some choices that they may not have thought about before.
Yeah. So now, what are some of the signature trainings that you actually conduct for corporations and nonprofits?
It's so interesting. Oftentimes I am conducting programs that companies or organizations are saying that their clientele or their employees are having problems with already. And I sort of adjust my programs I customize my programs to fit their needs. However, I have a couple of signature programs that seem to fall into almost everything that people are doing. And one of them is just around creating your playbook for success. You know, I talk to so many people who talk about wanting success. And then when I say, well, describe that to me, what does that entail? And they can't answer. And it's not because they don't want it, but it's because they oftentimes have been too busy to really think it through.
Yeah.
About what it is that they really want. So I help them formulate that. So creating your playbook for success is one. The other program that I talk about is DARE. And I get a lot of requests for the DARE program because that is dream, act, review, and excel. And the dream part is the part that many people limit. You know, they limit how big they can dream. And I tell them, you know, you can dream big and don't be overwhelmed by your own dream or overwhelmed by what people think you can and cannot do. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes we become our biggest critic and we choose not to dream because we don't want to fail. You know, and it's interesting. I heard someone say this, that you need to think past what's on the other side of fear. What's on the other side of fear? And and when you can start doing that, you can start dreaming bigger. And what's the worst that can happen? That's what's on the other side of fear. So I do that program quite a bit as well. And I've lately done a lot on unconscious bias training and doing that program as well. But the playbook and the DARE program are two signature programs that I've been doing for quite some time. And I enjoy doing a lot.
Can you talk to us a little bit more about the unconscious and bias training?
Sure. You know, so often we are we come with preconceived notions that we don't even think about. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we tend to talk about bias as it relates to how other people treat us.
Okay.
Without us thinking about what we think about other people as well. Mm-hmm. So we form these opinions. Oftentimes you don't even know you're forming the opinion, but I have people think about those things that they, how they think about other people.
Okay.
And then why they think, have they experienced it or do they just assume it? If they've experienced it, what happened? How did they, what part did they play in the process? Mm-hmm. And so I talk about unconscious bias in a way, not in a, not in an accusatory way, but in one that's more educational. It's an opportunity to communicate and discuss and think about the process, especially now in these very trying yeah. times. And I'm not going to get into the whole politics of it all, but mm-hmm. I think you understand what I mean, that we need to stop and sort of think about what we can do. We know there's a problem. Mm-hmm. And then I say, so what are we going to do about it?
I feel like you would have to actually act as a counselor with that type of training. Cause if I think, I feel like it would really just, is a lot of digging deeper into like the mindset and things people have experienced because of that training.
Well, absolutely. And I like the fact that you said mindset, because mindset is how you think and then how you act based okay. on that thought. Mm-hmm. And so I'm not the one who's doing the digging. I'm asking okay. the questions to help you dig, because gotcha. it really is about you. And because I'm a continual learner, mm-hmm. I ask those questions that make you sort of think about it, but I don't want to accuse you of anything. I just okay. want you to think about it. And oftentimes that means hearing the question over and over again and thinking about it far later than when I've asked the question. Mm-hmm. And I ask people to do that as well.
So with your trainings, because I just feel that individuals in the training, because everybody is, you know, different. Mm-hmm. Is it just a set training? Okay, this training is only going to last for 2 weeks, or is it more so a training whenever we resolve whatever we need to resolve, then that's how long it's going to take?
Well, I think it's a little bit of both. I might only be around for part of that training.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think that you have to keep asking that question. So I ask people who are in some of my training programs to get together and get an accountability partner.
Okay.
You want to hear from other people, how they might react to a certain situation. It's all about communication, I think, mm-hmm. and being open to learning a process. So that's why Stepwise was actually formed. Mm-hmm. It's one to help you ask questions of yourself and ask questions of others as well.
Okay. And these trainings are only for nonprofits and corporations, or do you also do the individual training?
I do individual training. I do individual coaching.
Okay.
Not on a regular basis now. I started out like that, mm-hmm. but I now like to, I enjoy talking to the masses.
Okay.
It's a better business model, so to speak, to be talking to a group of people than talking to just one person. Mm-hmm. So when I'm going to a corporation, it's so that I can talk to a group of people. I speak at a lot of conferences. I'm talking to a group of people. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't make a difference if it's a nonprofit or profit. And it almost doesn't make a difference what type of agency it is, okay. because it really is about the people. It's not about their title. It's not about their industry. It's about how they see themselves in the world, so to mm-hmm. speak.
Mm-hmm. So now I'm glad that you actually brought up your speaking engagements. What type of events would you like coordinators of these events to reach out for you for speaking engagements?
My sweet spot is talking about success strategies.
Okay.
And I think that success strategies, both personal and professional go hand in hand. Mm-hmm. So I may be talking about setting goals and developing a roadmap for your future. It might be preparing different things, both financial, spiritual, a family, as well as professional, might all go hand in hand. So I might be talking about that as it relates to success tips. I may be talking to individuals or groups that want to start their own business, mm-hmm. whether they want to become full-blown entrepreneurs or just develop their side hustle, so to speak. So things that they need to think about in that regard. I talk about networking. And you know, when you talk about legacy being a buzzword for you, I talk about networking being a buzzword because people tend not to do that well.
Okay.
They tend to think that if they're going to a networking event, then it's about collecting business cards, and then they don't follow up. I tell people that they need to look at who they already know as part of the network. And how long has it been since you've talked to those people who have helped you get to wherever it is you are now? Mm-hmm. I tell people that it's who do you know, who do you need to know, and who needs to know you? And quite frankly, rather than going out and getting those new people that you have not, you may not stay in touch with, how about touching base with those people you already know? They're people mm-hmm. who are already in your circle, so to speak, that you haven't contacted, you haven't spoken to. And I mean, and part of social media sort of makes you think you have. You know, you think because you liked their post or you commented on their post that you've connected with them. But I say, how about picking up the phone and making a call or sending an email and really asking how they're doing or asking, can you, when could you connect? And it doesn't have to be connect with, you know, a lunch or a dinner. And especially if you don't know them well, mm-hmm. I say, how about 5 minutes of their time without asking for anything? You're not asking for anything. You're asking them, how are they doing? And if it's, maybe it's, is there anything I can do for you? Or you read something about them. They were promoted, or they just had a baby, or they just got married. And giving a real congratulations, not the one that's already printed for you on the LinkedIn profile, on the LinkedIn message, but sending a note, mm-hmm. picking up the phone and leaving a message. That's more networking and having real touch points with people. So I talk about that a lot because I think that networking is going to move you to another level. That's a level up. Mm-hmm. And most people tend to forget to do it or make excuses why they can't do it.
Yeah. And I like what you mentioned in the other show about how you set a goal for yourself and you had, you know, your number for the entire year, but then you broke it down, you know, per month. And, you know, and you said, you know, you want to touch base with, you know, so many people like per week.
Yes.
How has that helped you to break it down like that?
You know, I think that I'm probably known for staying in contact with people. Mm-hmm. I do a self audit where I ask people for feedback, and almost all of them have paid attention to the fact that I stay in contact. And I'm busy, but you know what? I do things in small bite-sized pieces. I have I call it a 15-minute rule. I keep a 15-minute bucket list, a 15-minute bucket where I have notes and cards and people's addresses and both email and snail mail, believe it or not. Okay. And I send notes to people. And I call them up and say, you know what, just checking on you. Haven't spoken to you in a long time. And it doesn't make a difference how long that's been. You can make the first contact and you make it without asking for anything. Mm-hmm. And trust me, it works.
So now when you say 15-minute bucket list, that means that each day, possibly, if that's what you want it to be.
Yeah.
Like, for example, each day for 15 minutes, let's say you would write a note to somebody and then you mail it.
You can do that. Or I say 15 minutes as time to think. You know,
okay.
We have 1,440 minutes in a day.
Uh-huh.
We could take 15 minutes to do something that will better our lives.
Okay.
And when you look at what a small chunk that is, that mm-hmm. might be, you know, thinking, might be dreaming. That might be your dream time to really think about taking a dream out of storage. It might be contacting somebody, writing a note.
Okay,
it might be making a phone call or just self-care. You know, we can't, I think that we can't give from a empty cup.
Yeah.
So, you know, give from your overflow, but first you have to build, you have to put something in the cup. Mm-hmm. So where's the self-care for yourself? I think that that's so vitally important. So when I'm talking about speaking and coaching and workshops, I always include those kind of things because those are things that people tend not to think about.
Definitely. And I think that because we have so many other things that's pulling us at our time, you know, especially if, you know, people have kids or, you know, a spouse, then they're right there in their face, you know, as opposed to just putting something on the back burner and say, okay, well, I can do that later.
But you know what, when you're talking about a small amount of time, mm-hmm. then when you talk about your family being your excuse, and I do mean it's an excuse,
uh-huh.
because think about this, when you really, really want to do something, you make time to do it.
Right.
When you really don't want to do it, you make an excuse. Mm-hmm. So you either make time or you make an excuse. So I say, take 15 minutes out of that excuse and make time to do something that's going to benefit you. Because when you make time to do something that will benefit you, it will benefit your spouse mm-hmm. and it will benefit your kids in the long run. But you have to think about it in a different way. That's where mindset comes in.
That's good. That's good. And I'm glad that you said that because I think that I can't speak for anybody else, but sometimes I like that instant gratification.
Yeah.
So if I don't see something that I have done for over 3 days and I don't see any results, then I'm like, oh, this is not working.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Something else.
Yeah. Yeah. But you know, it does take longer than that. Mm-hmm. It's not going to be immediate gratification. Sometimes it will be, but it may not always be. And when you're given 15 minutes, that sort of helps the process, you know.
Yeah.
And I say to people that they should give themselves their best time of the day.
Mm-hmm.
So is your best time of the day, and I ask this of almost all of my clients, is your best time of the day early in the morning or midday or late at night? What's your, not when you think you have time, but what's your best time of the day? Mm-hmm. And that's the time you should give yourself to think.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And when you say our best time of the day, that means when we are like 100% and
at
we 100%. Are have our energy up.
That's
and everything.
That's it. And you know, I laugh because so many people say, well, I can't do that, but I'll multitask. And I'm saying, then you're not giving yourself, you're not giving 100% of your time to anything.
Mm-hmm.
And chances are you're not giving your best self.
Yeah.
So if you can establish things that you can do, you establish, I call them success routines or success mm-hmm. habits. And then you also set some priorities around that. And when you do that, you also teach people how to treat you.
That's good.
I think I laughed. I think I said this to you that I never turn my phone on first thing in the morning. I don't sleep with the phone in my room. And normally my cell phone goes off by 8:30 at night.
Mm-hmm.
And because I'm not going to accept texts because that's my time.
Yeah.
So you start that process. And at first, you know, I know people who go on vacation and they can't put their phone down. well, they're not fully relaxed. But if you tell people how to treat you, you know, we're not all brain surgeons. We don't always have to be on.
Yeah.
So I talk about, you know, giving yourself some time.
So what is your availability for your speaking engagements and training?
That's what I do. So people contact me on a regular basis and ask me about speaking at their organization. I hope more will do that. Yeah. I enjoy traveling to go speak at organizations and to speak at companies. Mm-hmm. I think that when people hear me speak, they can go back to their organizations and tell people about me. I have little snippets on my YouTube channel, and they can always contact me and tell me what they're thinking about doing. I'm now looking at availability and speaking engagements for 2020. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty booked up for this year, but there's a few little holes in there if people are interested. And I also, you know, a lot of, I like to say a lot of girlfriend kind of things happen. Girlfriends get together with a group. They can't, you know, one person can't afford to pay for me, but they get a whole group together and they all put so much money in and invite me to where they are. Mm-hmm. Or do what we're doing now, and they have a private session and they get to ask me any type of questions. I like doing that, especially now in preparation for the holiday and for the new year. Mm-hmm. And setting yourself up. You know, any day can be a good day to start something new.
Right. But
a lot of people tend to do that around this time of the year, the last quarter, you know, going strong for this last quarter and then for the new year as well.
Definitely. And I can really attest to just your ability to motivate us and really just, you know, just inspire us to just go that extra mile and just keep going because I'm actually going to be featuring Marsha's book for Sip and Read. So I'm so excited to be reading that book as well. And I think that that's so cool that you actually do the virtual trainings for groups of people. I think that is so nice. That's good.
Well, I think it's so important. And, you know, it eliminates one excuse. I didn't have time. I didn't have.
Right.
You know, I think that we need to just do some things for ourselves. And success is reachable for most people.
Right. Definitely. So what type of person do you feel needs to utilize your coaching service? Because I think that some people just may say, oh, I don't need to do all that. So, you know, I think that sometimes we need to be realistic in where we are at and where we desire to go and recognize that we need somebody to help us get to that next level.
I agree, but I also think that when people think, oh no, I don't need that, I'm doing everything that I need to do, I would ask them to think about how their life is going right now.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a gap between where they are and where they want to be? And what can they be doing about it? Sometimes it's hiring a coach because you don't know your own blind spots. And you oftentimes don't get feedback because you haven't asked for it or because people don't know how you will react if they gave you the feedback.
Okay.
So I'm saying that you should think about where you are. And if you think that you can use a boost for whatever it is you're trying to do, then you might want to hire a coach. And it doesn't have to be me, but it's someone who can help you go through the process of where you're trying to go.
But why would you be the best coach to help an individual go where they're trying to go?
You know what? I may not be the best coach for everyone. I'm not the best coach for everyone. There are people who contact me and I ask them questions about what they want to do and what they've done and what they are thinking about. And I say, you know what? I'm the wrong person for you. You know, I'm also, I also think it's important that the personality be right as well. So someone who thinks that they know everything and you know nothing shouldn't be working with a coach.
Yes.
You know, they should probably be working with a therapist, you know, or sometimes they want to, they don't want the feedback. And I tell you that that's probably the person who definitely shouldn't work with me because I'm pretty direct. So if someone thinks that they just want someone to just listen and not offer any feedback, that's not for me either. I'm the wrong person. And I'm okay with that.
Definitely. So now if you all are interested in utilizing Marcia's coaching services or want to contact her for your next event for a speaking engagement or training, make sure you go to the description box because her email is actually listed in the description box. So what, why did some of your past clients come to you for consulting services?
Well, they come to me for a couple of reasons. One, as I said, I'm pretty direct. I can also say that I have had experience in a lot of these areas that they find challenging. I'm confidential. Anything that they talk to me about, they're not going to hear that they said anyplace else. And that means whether I'm working with them through their company or on an individual basis. And I'm pretty good at what I do.
Come on, Marcia. That's what we want to hear.
I actually enjoy what I'm doing. You know, I think it's so, you see people who are working at jobs and they are just miserable.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not one of those people. I actually want to work with people who have the ability to have a good attitude. They may be suffering right now, but they have the ability to have a good attitude. I'm pretty positive, and I want other people to experience some of the things that I've been blessed with having. So I like working with those people.
And I really appreciate that you said that because so many times, one thing that I really dreaded hearing people say was, oh, I can't wait till Friday.
Yeah.
And I'm like, how do you live a life like that? Always just waiting for a Friday. And you have to still work that Friday. So you only have 2 days that you're enjoying.
I dare say, ask them what they did on Saturday and Sunday, and they'd be complaining about that too.
Yeah. Right. And so I just really appreciate people being around people that enjoy what they truly do, because that's really what I aspire to do as well. And just finding that job, that career that I truly enjoy doing. So if you are just at a place in your life where you feel like, you know, I truly just hate what I'm doing.
Or you feel stuck.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. If you feel stuck, you know, just reach out to Marcia and see if she is actually the right person for you, especially if you can actually go to your HR manager. If you see some type of environment or in your office and you feel that you need to bring in someone else, you know, let them know, you know, of somebody that could possibly just help the environment and create a culture that you enjoy working in, because we have to work so many hours of our life. So we might as well enjoy it.
And, you know, I get that quite a bit. Where someone has heard about me or spoken to me, and they go back and they talk to their HR department or their employee resource group, or just a group of friends or colleagues, and they say, let's try to get something together. So a lot of times I'm doing that. No group is too small. Well, you know, I'd like it to be a bigger group, yeah. but, you know, people put small groups together as well as large groups to get together, to have those kind of conversations.
So now, in the beginning of the show, I did mention that she was on Authors to Know and their books to read. If you missed that show, it's okay. I'm going to have Marcia talk a little bit about her book, The Little Black Book of Success. Can you just let the viewers know a little bit more about that book?
Sure. The Little Black Book of Success, Laws of Leadership is right here. I did this book with two other co-authors. We talk about leadership strategies, and we say the first person you lead is yourself. So how do you lead yourself? Our first chapter sort of starts you off with always consider yourself a VIP, but then you have to act like one. You can't just call yourself a VIP and not act like a VIP. So part of that is, how do you carry yourself? What's your brand? What's your image? How are your communication skills? You know, what do people say about you when you're not in the room? What do people say about you when you're in the room? And just go through that process. That's initially. We have things in the book that says, you know, reach back and bring others along, because it's lonely at the top. So you want to bring people along with you. One, because you're helping your community, but also because you want to bring other people to be with you, to talk to you, to share with you, and that you can learn from and they can learn from you. Mm-hmm. We talk about when it's time to leave, you know, developing your exit strategy. And I just remember on the webinar we were on, Authors on the Web, and we were talking about when you have a terrible boss. Yeah. And one of the women said, I just leave. And I said, well, have you learned anything from that? You know, what part did you play? And sometimes you have to stay at a company or a job because you're getting more than you think, but you haven't given yourself time to think about it. So if you're getting exposure, or if you're getting skill, or if you're getting knowledge, or if you're meeting people that you wouldn't necessarily meet, sometimes you want to stay at that job doing that despite the bad boss. And I then say, and you know, I've said this to you enough times, that you then learn to use strategy over emotion. And I do a lot of talking about strategy, because I think it's vitally important, and it's something that we don't do, we don't necessarily do well.
Well, I truly appreciate you being on this episode of Business Spotlight, just so we can, you know, just learn more about your organization, Stepwise Associates, just so that we can know of a resource to take to our corporation if we, you know, would like you to speak with our group of friends or our coworkers and things like that. I thank you all for tuning in to another episode of Business Spotlight. Remember, all of our contact information is in the description box, and we would love for you to like and follow our Facebook pages. Marcia, I hope you have a great night.
Great. I'm so glad to be here. I hope that people will sign up for to be on my newsletter as well. If they'll go to my website and join my mailing list, then they will get tips and strategies, not on an everyday basis. I'm not one of those that will flood your mailbox. As a matter of fact, most people say they're waiting for more because they don't do it. But I would love people to sign up. If they're interested, you'll get little tips and strategies, and they'll hear about things that I'm doing in the future, like this as well.
Excellent. And her website is in the description box as well. I hope you all have a great night, and we will talk to you all later. Bye-bye.